really can't focus on student achievement. So we got to make sure we're taking care of each other first. And focusing on my word of the week as far as righteousness, again, I had a few people came to mind. And so one of those people, I consider them a friend. I consider them a mentor for many of our students in Darlington County. And he and his peers are a group that I've grown close to and that I've been working with, and I'll explain a little bit of that as well. But at this point in time, I would like to bring in our guest, who is Pastor Chris Morgan, who also works for the city of Hartsville. And so I'm going to move my chair and invite Pastor Morgan in. Well, Chris, good morning.
Okay. Good morning, Chief.
And so you'll hear me go back. Sometimes I'll call you Chris, and sometimes I call you Pastor Morgan. And the reason why is I interact with you in several different ways, just like several of the folks that I have connected with since I've been here, right? And I think that's important because I recognize you as a respected pastor. And that is one of your fields of study, your primary field of study, and engagement. But I also recognize you as Chris because you're just a good guy that helps out my communities a lot with our students. And I'll get a text from Chris saying, hey, Dr. Newman, I got an issue with a family that's having an issue with school, and I need some advice. How can I lead them? Or I'll see you at a different meeting, and you'll say, well, hey, how about this situation in the community, right? But then there's other times that Pastor Morgan is who I really need to be talking to, right? And we first met one of the first weeks that I got here to the school district, and you and several of our other pastors came to the school district. And you wanted to be able to have a chance to meet me and talk with me. And then after we had a chance to talk and the group kind of gave me an overview of how they saw the school district and how they like to be part of the school district and part of my new tenure in the school district. Then we were able to pray together and we held hands. And we formed that bond. And I think that bond has only grown since that time. So just talking a little bit from your perspective, how do you see your role, how has that changed with the school district over the past couple of years, and maybe some of your peers as well?
I think, first and foremost, excuse me, thank you again for allowing me to be here. I think I would speak for myself and other pastors, seeing the need to really be a part of the development of our children. We see the need for not just teachers, students, and principals to take the mantle and just to be aggressively involved with, you know, educating the children, but as an element of education that needs to be addressed, that we as particularly pastors and Christian leaders, we need to aggressively assume that's the moral aspect cannot be disassociated with education. It has to be a part of it in the vein or in the lane that we can operate in. So I think it's important for pastors and Christian leaders who lead their communities and who are in touch with the people in their communities to be able to work with the school district. It's been a blessing to have the transparency since I've been involved and with the Greater Hartsville Ministerial Alliance and other pastors in the surrounding areas who really, I think, are appreciative of the opportunity to come in to see exactly what's going on in our schools and to see who is teaching them and who are the people overseeing them, and also to find out what the faith community can do to assist in the development of our students. So it's been a great opportunity.
That's great. Well, you know, you mentioned the ministerial groups, and so we've kind of put some things together over time. And when I say we, the pastors and ministers, as well as the school district, we've been kind of expanding how we're growing to help our students. And one of the things I have really made a point for people to know is that there seems to be a misunderstanding that churches are not allowed to be involved in schools, right? That there's some people that interpret that churches cannot have anything to do with public schools. And the reality is that any volunteer can have any involvement in our schools as long as they meet the criteria, right, from the public school standpoint. And I've always said the second largest place that addresses our children and addresses their needs is in our local churches. So not only do we want to engage with our local churches, but we need to be plugged into our local churches, mm-hmm. because you hear about things differently but similarly than we hear about things, right? And so and it's a way of getting information out, right? Because you know the students in our communities are normally with us 5 days a week, and there's information that's going to get out. We know that our students are Wednesday, Sunday, and maybe another day or evening in our churches. And so if we can collaborate on how we're getting information out, that's what this is about. We understand that there are legal set lines between church and state. That's not in question. But we also understand people that are willing to help our children and be mentors and have input on how things would be better, we all need to welcome that.
Yes.
And you know, that comes a lot from our churches, but it also comes from our businesses, right? And it also comes from other volunteers and community agencies. So I'm just glad that we've been able to connect in this way. And you know, we've got the pastor's minister's cabinet, just like we have the business cabinet and the teacher cabinet. And we've experienced some new things with the minister's pastor's cabinet, because y'all had a chance to tour some of the new buildings, but you've also had a chance to tour some of the old buildings, right? Mm-hmm. And you've had a chance to what you were mentioning earlier, is see some of the people teaching in the buildings, but see the environment that the kids are in and what those old buildings look like versus what those new buildings look like. And then we get together after that and we debrief. Mm-hmm. And we talk about, what did you see? And you all have had some pretty challenging questions that you've asked. But they're the right questions, okay? And so none of us should shy away from the right questions. So from your perspective, seeing the old buildings and the new buildings, what are some of your thoughts about that?
Well, I think there needs to be more new buildings, to say the least. However, I do appreciate the upkeep and what's being done to weather the storm with the status quo of the building that are old. I think the new building will create a better environment. And since the newness, safety, I think that was one of the big things about how the building was constructed to be safe and secure. So overall, I appreciate the thought that behind the buildings and the buildings. I just wish that it could be more done, but I know it takes time. So overall, in light of all the old buildings, I think that the teachers, the administrators, the janitorial staff do a good job of at least preserving and keeping it in a sense whereby it still can be conducive for learning. So of course, in the ideal world, we have all new buildings for everybody. It can't happen right now, but the new buildings that are there, I think will be put to use. I think it will actually help elevate maybe the learning curve of some of the students with them.
And so it was interesting because one of our last tours that we had, I think, you know, we normally eat lunch together and share in that environment the questions and everything, and it's usually in our old buildings. And so when the group is in, like, the new building, when you visited King, for example, it's these big wide hallways with bright colors and light coming through the windows all over the place and space. And then we come and we meet and have lunch together and break bread together. in this really dark, low ceiling, you know, not a real bright type of environment. And it's a real, to me, it's a stark contrast about the environment, how children will learn in the environment, right? And so one of the big reasons, I'm thankful that the school district has started the three buildings that we're currently on, but hopefully we'll be able to continue in some form or manner, because you can't walk in an old building and a new building and not see how much better that would be for a child to learn, right? And for them to want to be in that environment. It's not necessarily the only thing, but it certainly doesn't hurt to have an environment that's kid-friendly, right? And learning friendly. So, I was thinking about some of the items that as a district, you know, of course, the Ministerial Alliance that I've met with in both Hartsville and Lamar, the cabinets that we have, and we've done the tours together, and there seems to be more pastors and ministers from all of our communities that have been added as we've gone along with that. I know I participated in the Lamar bus incident program that we had a few months ago as a way of, again, not being from here, but wanting to understand our community and understanding the hurts that are there in the healing process that needs to take place too. So, you know, I feel as if we are growing. And when I say we, all of the people that are involved, but most importantly, how we're trying to help our children and help our communities together. And so, I have to tell you, Chris, Pastor Morgan, one of the things that's been on my heart over the past several weeks is, obviously, you look at what's going on around the country, and you know that our children, right, our communities, the kids that are in our community, the school district's kids, your church's kids, right, they're all watching this on TV. And I have really struggled with that because I feel for what's going on. And I'm trying to figure out how to express it, right? I'm trying to figure out how do I reach out to our children and our communities. And so, you know, for example, this isn't a legal issue. It's not a political issue. Those, I leave that to others, okay? But it's a community issue. And my thought is that we are all, if we're gonna say we're community, we're all one family, right? And in that family, we take care of each other. We grieve together. We celebrate success together. We do everything together. And that family doesn't care whether you're black, white, yellow. That family just cares that you're family, right? And so for me, I need to help my family, and I need to help our communities and our children. Most important, that's my focus, is our children, because they're trying to figure out what to do with all this too, and they need folks to lead them through this, like you do, and I feel that's part of my responsibility. So talk to me about what you think we can do, whether it be the school district or our churches or, mm-hmm. or any other organizations, on how we can help specifically our children and work through some of the things that we're dealing with.
Sure. I think it's the elephant in the room. Dr. King said that rioting is the language of the unheard. It's trending in media, social media, media outlets. The topic is George Floyd. And unfortunately, his tragic death. But I think this is an opportunity for America, for communities at large and local communities to learn and to take something that was bad and not to make light of it, but ultimately to not let it happen again, but use it for good. And let me explain myself. But in a way, the picture of, that's that graphic picture, or the horrific picture of seeing his death, which all over the world people are looking at. And a lot of people don't know how to process their thoughts. But I just want to express that in the community, one of the things that's an issue is that what you said is ideal. We all should rejoice one with another. We should celebrate one another, and we should genuinely feel a part of a community, a family. But what we're seeing is a minority group, African-Americans especially, who feel as if they're not considered to be a part of the community. Even though the rhetoric or the ideal may say you are, but the experience isn't like that. I just want to say that seeing a man with his knee on someone's neck is an expression of not just oppression, but it's a picture of what African-American community have dealt with since they've been here. And this is not a political or narrative at all. It's just something I began to look at and see that he was struggling to breathe, but he was saying words that he couldn't breathe. And that process of time led to his ultimate death. What caught my attention was the other people who were around him, people who were in other offices, who were in power, leadership, particularly in power, they witnessed something that was wrong. But they didn't lift a finger to help it. That's what the ire is about. We all know there's been violence since Cain killed Abel. And unfortunately, it's going to be here until God makes a change, makes all things new. However, the thing that we can do to not let that happen, unfortunately, you know, people can do wrong things. But when there are others who witness it, who are in a position of power, who can stop it, don't do anything, that provokes what's happening now. And so with that being said, I really gave it some thought of how practical ways in which, you know, we as a whole can change. You know, number one, love your neighbor as yourself. And we hear that commandment, but oftentimes we look at what we don't need to do to hurt somebody. But we don't look at the opposite side of that. When someone is hurting, what are you doing to help them? And the Good Samaritan expresses that, what God means when he speaks about loving your neighbor as yourself. When, ironically, you have two races of people, the Samaritans and the Jewish nation, they are diametrically opposed one to another. They were prejudiced against one another. But a man is traveling, he's robbed and left half dead, and people in authority, my neck of the woods, are religious leaders, civic leaders who saw him, but did not want to help the situation. But then someone came, a Samaritan came around and saw a hurt man, a man who had dealt with injustice in a condition where he couldn't help himself. And he stopped what he was doing to get involved to help this person who suffered an injustice. It took him out of his comfort zone. Even he utilized his own resources because he understood he had a moral obligation to God and to humanity to love his neighbor as himself. And that's the overall lesson that humanity needs to adopt. And I think, number one, the people who are in positions of authority, influence, African-American people, and I'm saying this to highlight, right, because we're a community,
right?
I know sometimes it's an uncomfortable conversation, but when it's coming from the right place, I believe in being solution-minded, you know? And ultimately, the enemy is not humanity. The enemy is sinful hatred. That's the enemy. That's the common enemy we share, and we have to keep our focus and be objective about what really the enemy is. Hating someone, that's sin, that's unrighteousness. You know, Satan, that's the enemy. And we're created to be obvious, love one another, as the commandment expresses. And the only way really to do that is to really, you know, turn from our unrighteous ways as humanity, as a nation, as a community. And the things that are not right toward our Creator, toward one another, we have to amend them. Let's stop doing them and do as your word of the week says, do what's righteous.